everyone. Can I have everybody's attention? I know you guys are all having lunch, and it's really important to you guys, but we're going to talk about a very special event today. So today we're going to have a town hall meeting, and luckily we have the Coalition to Defend Affirmative Action and Integration and Immigrant Rights and Fight for Equality by Any Means Necessary right here today. We got a representative. His name is Hoku Jeffrey, and we have Aarefah. We also want to say thank you to the club members from La Casa and the GSA for being here. And we'll get started with Mr. Hoku Jeffrey. Can I have a round of applause, please?
Hi again, my name is Hoku Jeffrey, and the name of our organization, I'll just repeat it again, is the Coalition to Defend Affirmative Action, Integration, and Immigrant Rights, and Fight for Equality by Any Means Necessary, and I'm a national organizer for BAMN. When Aarefah Mosavi, who will speak in a little bit, decided that she was going to take the fight to get justice for the rape that was done to her public, she made a really important and uncommon decision. She decided that what she was going to do was to name her rapist when she attended Mount San Antonio College. That's when she was raped on that campus. And she was going to describe in detail what he did to her as part of her fight to counter the lies that the Mount San Antonio College administration, including Lorraine Jones, who works here at the Riverside Community College District now, that the lies that were being said against her. And when she did that, she exposed Lorraine Jones as a key part of the Mount San Antonio College administration's efforts to cover up her rape, but not only her rape, but the rapes and sexual harassment of a number of other students that came forward to us that didn't want to take their fight public, but they wanted to make sure that we knew what had happened to them and Lorraine Jones' role in doing that. Jones has been hired in the RCCD in your guys' district as the district compliance officer. That basically means she'll have the same role that she had at Mount San Antonio College as an equal EEOP director and the Title IX coordinator. She'll have the same responsibilities, some of the same responsibilities, except she'll be doing it on all the three campuses of your guys' district. She was hired without telling students or professors about her hiring. And the only reason to do that is because you know that as the Board of Trustees or whoever's doing the hiring, that if you were to tell someone who exactly it was you were hiring, that it would be so unpopular that you wouldn't be able to do it. And so that's why they didn't tell anyone. And by just the one act, the simple act of taking her on, of hiring her as the district compliance officer, means that they've sent a message to the entire Riverside Community College District that rape and sexual assault will not be taken seriously. And since they will not take it seriously, that's what brings us here today. Because it means that the students of the Riverside Community College District, the staff, the professors, but mainly the students, led by the students, have to be the ones to take this issue seriously and fight to get her fired. There was a federal report issued, I think it was 2013, by the Department of Justice. The title of it was "The Rape and Sexual Assault Victimization Among College-Age Females Age 18 to 24. The study covered the years 1995 to 2013. And in that study, they found that young women years 18 to 24 years old are at the highest risk to be raped or sexually assaulted, not only in general in life, but on college campuses in particular. And Aarefah has another figure around that. But there was also a movie made called The Hunting Ground. And the documentary was about national colleges and campuses and university campuses and their terrible record of their insistence, it almost seems like their insistence on covering up incidences of rape and sexual assault. And woman after woman coming forward saying that how the administration covered up their assault. At UC Berkeley now, get back to UC Berkeley in a second. At Mount SAC, we basically, when Aarefah made her statement public, she released it, we released it, her and BAMN, we released it on YouTube. It's got over 18,000 views now, where she basically says what happened, what Chester did to her, what the Mount SAC administration did to cover up the rape. You can see it's on the flyer that was passed around in the story on the back, where Aarefah details what Chester did to her, what the attack was. You can see the actual YouTube, where you can go find the video on YouTube. And so it went. A lot of people saw it. We went to Mount SAC. We organized marches. We organized pickets of Chester Brown, the rapist, his workplace. We spoke out at the Board of Trustees meeting. The first march was modest, 80 students, 100 students around there. And the other marches, 30, 40. But it presented a method for how to fight rape and sexual assault that could get somewhere, that could have the possibility of winning. And so when Aarefah went to UC Berkeley, they made the same fight there, and Aarefah worked with another young woman to get a rapist kicked off of their campus. And as a result of that fight, some of you guys may have seen this in the news, now UC Berkeley has had four, a law school dean, a basketball coach, a professor, some other person I'm not remembering right now, who have all been made to resign. They've all been made to resign, even though in one of the cases, the administration knew about the person's sexual harassment for 10 years. Yet they've never done anything. But the rapists only succeed in being able to do what they do when things are not brought out to the light of day. And we want to make what Aarefah has been able to do more common. And so I think that's all I want to say. The last thing I want to know before Aarefah speaks is just, like I said, the only reason they did not tell any students or professors about why they were hiring Lorraine Jones is because they knew it was going to be really unpopular. There's already a mobilization that's being called for April 5th at the Board of Trustees meeting. And I think that it's really important starting now that this be as public as possible on the campus. I heard there was a newspaper article, and that's important. But it's important now that some students start to take this campaign to the whole campus. That's our power. That's how we can get her off of this campus. Not only that, but that's how we can get rape and sexual assault taken seriously here. And actually, the question of, there's a question I think, I would say something about it. And yet, why do this now? Why are we going to be insisting that this fight be taken public as much as possible now? Why students in the lead of this now? And that's just because students are going to be the only people who are going to fight in the most determined way to make sure that Lorraine Jones does not have the ability to cover up rape and sexual assault on this campus and on these campuses. No one else will fight that in that determined a way. And that's the one thing she's got going for her right now, is the not enough people knowing that she's here and what she's done. We've got to take that Aarefah's video, her whole statement, what they did, what the role the Mount SAC administration did to cover up the rape, take that to the student body. This federal lawsuit is going to be ongoing. So if the Board of Trustees would like to hang on to Lorraine Jones, then they can have a scandal every single time there's a hearing in our case and Aarefah speaks to the public and BAMN speaking to the public about a federal lawsuit involving a cover-up of rape and sexual assault that Lorraine Jones had her hands all in. So I'll give it over now to Aarefah and, yeah. One other thing, if anyone wants to help out with this campaign, there's our table right over there. Adam there, feel free to talk to him, get Flyers Mari's over there, and you know, you can sign on then, yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Aarefah Mosavi. I want to begin by thanking each and every one of you for attending this crucial event. In light of administrative cover-ups of rape and sexual assault on our campuses across the country, I ask all of you to please join us in our effort to defend the dignity and basic civil and human liberties of rape survivors, including myself. I am here today because this administration has insolently chosen to hire the woman who was responsible for trying to cover up the fact that I was raped. I am here today because this administration neglected the fact that Lorraine Jones is being sued by me as part of a federal lawsuit that aims to reclaim what dignity was stripped from me. Rape is a criminal felony. It is a crime against humanity. It is a form of genocide, and it is absolutely sickening to see those in higher positions of authority willfully fail those whose rights have been unjustly stripped from them. The recognition, preservation, and protection of our dignity is not an option. It is an obligation. It is an inalienable human right. I will begin by recounting how I was assaulted, then I'll proceed to how my rights were abused by Mount San Antonio College's negligent administration thereafter, most notably by Lorraine Jones. On the night of December 12, 2013, I was sexually assaulted on the farm of Mount San Antonio College. The assailant was a coworker of mine who was allowed to continue to work on campus even after he had assaulted me. His name is Chester Brown. On night Thursday, December 12, 2013, we went to the campus farm to see animals. Mount Sac is a relatively wealthy college campus that has its own farm. As we were getting ready to leave the farm, Brown suddenly turned to me and repeatedly asked me to take off my hijab, to which I consistently refused and expressed that he was making me uncomfortable. I stated that I simply wanted to go home, to which he claimed to have understood. At this point, Brown was behind me. We were heading back to where his car was parked when I noticed that he had stopped walking. I turned around to see him with his arms outstretched. He said he wasn't going to leave without a hug. I walked towards him and told him that he was being ridiculous. He then grabbed my arm against my will and pulled me against him. I was frozen and terrified. It was dark and there were no other people present around me. I was terrified as he proceeded to sexually assault me. He forced his hands under my shirt, groping my bare stomach, then forced his hands under my bra and groped my breasts. He then continued to grope my stomach, sides, and lower back. While he was doing this, he was also grinding his body against me in a rough manner. I was in a complete state of shock throughout this entire ordeal. I felt like if I did anything to stop him, he was going to do something far worse to me. Brown then continued to rape me by putting his hand outside of my stretched jeans and in between my thighs. He pushed his finger into me at least three times so that his finger and the fabric of my jeans went inside my genitalia. It was painful. I looked around to see if there was anybody close by that I could seek help from, but I couldn't see anyone. I felt trapped. I was frozen the entire time. After about 5 minutes of this rape and sexual assault, he stopped and said, "I feel like I forced myself on you. I knew something like this was going to happen." We started walking back to his car, which was parked nearby. My belongings were in his car. Also, I was in a dark and unfamiliar place, and I needed to ride back to where I had left my car, which was parked very far away from the farm. I walked behind him dazed and in silence. I felt incredibly violated and sick, like I wanted to vomit. I felt dirty. He drove me to my car in the parking lot across from Building 4, which is the administration building. He parked his car next to mine, and as I went to leave, he grabbed my arm and again demanded that I remove my headscarf. And as I pulled away to get out of the car, Brown pulled my coattail, but I snatched it back and left in my car. I felt so filthy and violated that I washed myself upon arriving home. I reported to my supervisors, who directed me to the Title IX coordinator, Lorraine Jones. Lorraine Jones wouldn't avail herself to me for an entire week. I was never a priority to the Title IX coordinator throughout this investigation. Other meetings were constantly scheduled before me, and in some cases, Jones had even canceled important meetings with me, which ultimately resulted in a botched and incomplete investigation. Jones allowed rapist Chester Brown to continue to work during the investigation without my knowledge. In fact, I found out when I encountered him on a weekly basis after class. He was allowed to work in the same building where I attended classes. Lorraine Jones refused to change his schedule when I complained of running into him on a weekly basis. Instead, she callously told me to report to her if he touched me or said anything to me. In other words, I had to wait for him to violate me once more in order for her to do her job. On April 4, 2016, Lorraine Jones told me to simulate how I was raped onto another woman, and that if I didn't comply, she would accuse me of lying and of not cooperating with the investigation. I described the assault that took place but was unable to go through simulating the rape. I failed to see why this would have been asked of me or the scribe. Yet Jones and the administration used the fact that I did not go through with the simulation to further justify exonerating Chester Brown. In emails, Lorraine Jones agreed to interview my witnesses. She lied to me. In the end, none of my witnesses were ever interviewed. Instead, she took ignorant and biased opinions of Chester Brown's coworkers and friends, opinions of individuals who were not present to witness how I was sexually assaulted by him, and claimed them as valid witnesses in her conclusion. I had warned Jones of specific people who had biased opinions of Brown through emails and in person, but this concern, along with many others, were left ignored. Lorraine Jones refused to give me records of the notes she took during interviews. She refused to communicate with me via email on certain occasions. She did everything she could to ensure that I wouldn't have a record of her disgraceful misconduct. Lorraine Jones lied in the administrative review and claimed that I gave two drastically different accounts, when third-party college media reported that my accounts closely matched. The fact that she refused to give me copies of my records further indicate that she behaved only to cover her tracks and wrongfully deny the validity of my own experience. Lorraine Jones repeatedly asked me throughout the investigation when I was transferring in hopes that this issue too would disappear from the campus. She has been mistaken. Jones deliberately traded my safety and the safety of other students for a miserable price, and she will suffer the hand of justice by the time I'm through with her. My civil and human liberties were violated at nearly every stage of this botched investigation. It is reprehensible for the president of the Board of Trustees to incompetently state that she is not at all concerned that Jones is holding the same position she abused in Mount Sac. I am not the only student that was subjected to Lorraine Jones' failures. Your administration has already been caught covering up incidences of rape and sexual assault by underreported crime statistics. Students of Riverside Community College, your administration failed you all by secretly hiring Lorraine Jones without your knowledge, input, or consent. The definition of a democracy is an institution that is ruled by a majority with respect to minority rights. This is your campus. You are the majority. You are the backbone upon which this institution depends, and you are the vitality that breathes life into this vicinity. It is up to you to prevent this administration from repeating the same mistake of hiring yet another civil and human rights abusing officer of compliance. I thank you for your time.
I don't know if there are any, I think that's all I have, and that's all she has to. Is there anybody that has any, wants any questions? Anybody wants to ask of us? Can I ask for a raise of hands? How many of you guys did know before we walked in the room that, just raise your hands, that Lorraine Jones was a new hire and that she had done this stuff?
Okay. Didn't know.
So you said did not know?
Did not know.
How many of you did know?
Oh, did. No.
Did already. So, but yeah, but this is. So okay, so that's what we have. I think that's what we have to fix between now and the Board of Trustees meeting on April 5th. Everybody has to know this, because it's not just does Lorraine Jones get to be district compliance officer. It's how many rapes and sexual assaults go without anything being done about them. How many young women have to be on a campus where their rapist, that their assailant, they see constantly. The report on rape and sexual assault that was talking about how the depression, the PTSD, the things that the people get left with from these assaults, it's about the whole future of the young people on these campuses. And so, but yeah. You could ask a question, or if there's anything you just want to say about what we said. I know one. Okay, well, there's some things that may be useful for you. Just so I know this was useful at Mount SAC, just for people to know. The Department of Justice Rape and Sexual Assault Report says that 80% of rapes occur between people that know each other. It's not the random person jumping out of the bushes. It's someone you have a familiarity with in some way. And so.
I also wanted to add that the statistic has been wavering from one out of every four college women will be in their lifetimes a victim of sexual assault and rape, and the other one is one out of every five women. And I believe the current statistics for males, one that was a bit outdated said one out of 33, however, a 2016 publication stated that one out of every six males can actually be or will be victims of sexual assault in their lifetimes. I just believe that those statistics are incredibly pertinent to everybody here because you are college students and you deserve to know the statistics for your own safety.
Hey guys. I actually attended Mount San Antonio College, and I didn't know someone like Lorraine Jones was at my school asking students to simulate the rape on a note taker. And to me, asking a rape survivor to simulate the rape is the dehumanization, the re-victimization, the oppression, the instilling of fear into rape survivors to make sure that they don't go on with the investigation so schools can look safe, so administrators can look safe, so Title IX coordinators like Lorraine Jones look like they're doing a good job. Lorraine Jones was a failure. She failed to properly take notes on Aarefah's investigation. She failed to communicate with Aarefah when she needed her the most. She failed other women who were sexually harassed on campus. These harassers, some of them are still on campus, and she hasn't done anything about it. And now we exposed her at Mount San Antonio College, and guess what? She fled. But she fled to another college, your guys' college, and she's here now. And obviously, she's going to fail you guys too. And the fact that you guys didn't even know that she's working here is a failure. The fact that you guys probably don't even know where her office is. I don't even know what she looks like. So this is a good cover up of rape and sexual assault. The campuses try to cover it up, defend her name, but obviously people like Lorraine Jones and other administrators who are doing the same thing as her don't deserve to work with students, don't deserve these positions. They should be fired, and students should demand the resignation of Lorraine Jones now. So.
Yeah, I just want to thank everybody for giving us, you know, some of their time. It's really important that we all actually take this seriously. We get active. They're going to have a Board of Trustees meeting, I believe, April 5th or 6th. And we all need to get involved because this is unacceptable and it's happening at our campus. We need to get involved and we got to make sure that this doesn't happen again and that we hold the people that are running this school accountable. So I encourage every one of you guys to get together. Talk to me after this when it's done and let me know. I can give you guys the information. We can get together to the Board of Trustees meeting and send them a message that this is unacceptable and that we are the people. We have the power. We need to tell them that they're here to serve us and not their self-interest. So I thank you guys. Thank you, Hoku, for coming. Thank you, Aarefah, for giving a powerful speech. And thank you, everybody, for giving us your time.